Yo. That was literally Blade Runner, Cowboy Bebop, and Ghost in the Shell all just wrapped into one.
Oh.
That's what that is.
That's it. Not only.
So look, we got the team here.
You got time.
We're gonna surprise Paris. Surprise
him. Here he comes.
He has no idea. Look, I got everybody over here. Look. Yeah, go. Yeah. So we have the whole team here waiting for Paris to come out. And they're gonna come up.
MJ, Fabi, I'm this side.
I can't wait. Fantastic game. I'm so excited to talk about this game. I got to talk about this game. We got to go talk about it.
We got to go talk about it.
We got to go. We got to go. Let's go.
All right, everybody. Thank you for joining me. This is an emergency stream YouTube video podcast that I wanted to do. This is Paris Gamertag Radio. And it's been a few days since E3, and there's been a lot of news that has obviously happened during the week of E3, and there were 10 million podcasts that we put out for Gamertag Radio during E3, so I want to thank Danny and Pete for doing that. Unfortunately, my time at E3 this year was very limited, so I didn't get to see a lot in person, but the stuff that I did get to see, I for sure want to kind of just give a brief overview of it really quick, and then just jump into my main topic, which is going to be Cyberpunk 2077 and just everything that happened this week with CD Projekt Red at E3 and just my overwhelming excitement about that game and about that studio and what I think they're going to be able to do here coming up in April. The other thing, obviously, I'll do at the end will be Anthony Davis going to my Lakers and what that means for the NBA, because obviously the NBA finals just ended. Congratulations to the Toronto Raptors, Kawhi Leonard, finals MVP. They did deserve it. They earned it. But hey, Golden State, they had some catastrophic injuries along the way, and that just completely just changes the landscape of the NBA as we go into the 2019-2020 season. So let's start off with this. Let's just start off E3. So like I said, I won't go too in-depth with my thoughts of E3, but it all started for myself on Sunday. Went to that Xbox media briefing and everything that was that entailed in there. Obviously, Xbox Game Pass Ultimate was a highlight. I think that is a fantastic service that Microsoft is providing for $15 a month. Right now, if you spend $1 to get 1 month of Ultimate and you already have existing Xbox Live Gold or a Game Pass subscription on your account, it will auto-upgrade it to Ultimate. So as an example, I had Xbox Live Gold until June of 2022. I now have Xbox Live. God, I can't even, so many acronyms. I have Xbox Game Pass Ultimate now until June of 2022, and I only had to spend $1 to do that upgrade, so that was fantastic. And now it'll be on PC, on the console. Gold is bundled in as well. It's fantastic value for $15 a month. Obviously, beyond that announcement, we got to see some more of Gears 5. We obviously at the end of the show got Halo Infinite. We got to see another teaser for that. They teased Project Scarlet, which will be the next console for Xbox coming holiday 2020. And then the thing that absolutely stole the show at the Xbox media briefing was Cyberpunk 2077 and the fact that Keanu Reeves is now in the game and he's playing Johnny Silverhand. And he was at the briefing, and it was just like this ultimate rock star moment to see him walk out on stage. And I know I jumped up and clapped and cheered. It was just an awesome thing to see. So that's like what kicked it off for E3 for me. And then that kind of rolled into that evening. Went to Ubisoft, had like a little happy hour they were doing during the Bethesda press conference. So I went over there, hung out with some of those Ubisoft star players, kind of, you know, just talk gaming, things of that nature. And then I went home and then I went to work. And then Monday evening, I came back to E3. I got to go to another private event, got to hang out with some people from Bungie. That was really great. Got to talk to some of those guys, just kind of, hey, where Destiny 2 is headed, Shadowkeep, all that stuff. Just great connections with that. And then after that, I went to, and I screw up the naming of this, so I do apologize, but the point of it is great. Actually, let me backtrack. First, I went to Ubisoft, had their showcase. I did not go to their media briefing, but I went to the Ubisoft showcase. I got hands-on with Ghost Recon Breakpoint, and that was interesting because originally we thought we were going to have like 2 hours of being able to play the game, which wound up turning like 20 minutes. We didn't really get a lot of time to play the game, and then we did an interview right after, and that was kind of it. So my thoughts on Breakpoint is kind of incomplete at this point because I didn't get a lot of time with it. I didn't really get to sink my teeth into it and really deep dive into what I thought Breakpoint was going to be. But it's definitely different than Wildlands, for sure. It is a little more tactical, the survival elements. I could see it on the surface, but I really need more time with Breakpoint to give an honest opinion about it. And I just know overall from hearing people at the show, the opinions have been mixed. So did the showcase. Actually, I did a showcase first, then I did the Bungie thing. And then after the Bungie thing, I then went to another Ubisoft event. And this is called, I'm going to screw this name up. This was for a mixer for basically black content creators that were at E3. I'm just going to say it that way. And this had nothing to do with games. This was just a space that was sponsored by Ubisoft. Shout out to Esco Blades for putting this together because it was a fantastic event. We're basically people of color. We all got together Monday night and we just hung out. We just hung out. We talked shop. There was no sales pitch, nothing. You even go check my Twitter timeline. I put a quick video up of the speech that Esco was giving at the start of the mixer, but it was fantastic. And I really hope that we start to see more of these because look, I don't know if I'm the voice of this, a champion. I do not pretend to be at all, but I'm very adamant that we need more people of color in this space, in this industry. There's some brilliant people out of there that are just not getting the spotlight that they deserve. We need to, and I'm not talking just on the content creator side, I'm talking on the development side as well. We need more light shown on people of color in this industry because we're out here, we play the games just like everyone else, we enjoy the games just like everyone else, we help make the games, we consume the games, we make content around the games, we do everything of the above. So I want to see more of that for sure. So again, going back to that mixer, it was fantastic to see a lot of people of color that were at E3. We all got together and it was just a great time. It was a fun time. There was no drama. Like I said, there's no sale pitch, nothing. We just talked shop and it was fantastic. And the highlight for me on a personal level was I got into this deep conversation with this one gentleman and we're just talking. And then all of a sudden someone goes, N'Guy Kroll. And I'm like, and I'm going to curse. Oh shit. I've been talking to N'Guy Kroll and did not realize it because he cut his dreads and it wasn't clicking with me as I'm talking to him. And I felt like an idiot. But we continued the conversation, got more in depth, had a nice long conversation with N'Guy Kroll. And that was an absolute highlight for me because at being a person of color himself, he's definitely been one of my inspirations in this industry going way back in the day, really kind of being the only person of color, the only face that we would see up on a stage with a Jeff Keighley or something like that at a panel or whatever, you know, talking, you know, with Gerstmann, all those guys just over the years, being able to sit there with them and talk about the industry at the time, the trends that were going on from his point of view. We even got into a conversation, you know, about how he thought about the whole Resident Evil 5 controversy from back in the day, if you guys remember that. But definitely a highlight for me for that night. It was just really great. A lot of fun with that. So that was kind of my E3, really, because then I had to go to work. I had just work obligations. I did not come back to E3 again until the last day, probably about 1 o'clock in the afternoon. I was actually able to go on a show floor. And yeah, it was an interesting afternoon indeed. First and foremost, you know, I've talked a lot about, E3 losing its relevance as far as just being a show and a spectacle. And that was very apparent. Not only EA being gone, not only Activision not having a booth on the show floor, Xbox being across the street, but PlayStation. It felt weird not seeing PlayStation in West Hall. I mean, Nintendo was still there, but West Hall just was not the West Hall that I've had fond memories of over the past decade or so. And then, you know, South Hall was a little better. Bethesda was over there. Ubisoft was over there. WB Games was over there. They had the big Cyberpunk public booth over there, things like that. I mean, it was a little more kind of the typical E3 vibe in South Hall, but West Hall just felt off. It just felt weird to me. But like I said, I'm not going to get into too much of that other than to say, thanks to the good folks over at Ubisoft, I was able to jump up into a meeting room and sneak in some playtime with Watch Dogs Legion. And I loved it. I loved it. It absolutely shot up to probably my second most anticipated game coming between now and early 2020. I love the concept of basically being able to recruit these NPCs, and they all have their strengths and their weaknesses and their own backstories and their own things that they need assistance with. And you recruit them, you go help them with their problem. They join your team and you can send them out on a mission. It was really good. I mean, it definitely, you know, the Watchdog hooks were in there for sure. Just kind of that near future hacking and everything that went along with that. And the mission I did was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed it. And I truly anticipate if Ubisoft is able to pull this off, March 2020, I definitely will be picking that up day one to check it out and play it. But let's just jump into the main event here. So the thing that really got me at that event at E3 was Cyberpunk 2077. And I've talked about this game over and over the past year. Obviously, you go back to the video that Danny took of my reaction coming out of the demo from E3 2018 and just my genuine reaction and just how I felt about everything. It went viral. A lot of people over at CD Projekt Red kind of picked up on it. You know, I've kind of been Twitter friends with some of them back and forth. So I was even talking with some of them leading up to E3, and they're excited for me to come. I was excited to go. And I even ran into one person in PR that helped me get into the demo this year right before I went in. He was like, "Are you excited? Are you ready?" I'm like, "Yes, I'm ready." And just the anticipation. I purposely booked the very last showing they had at E3 on Thursday just to make sure if there was any way possible I could make it. I figured, hey, the last one I'd be able to make it. Sure enough, I was able to get out there to go see it. So I go in the demo, and I'll jump into the demo and just my thoughts here in just a second. But it was just surreal. The demo was at about 5, but I actually went over to the CD Projekt Red meeting room. I don't know, about 4:15, 4:20. I had Danny with me, and we just kind of just hung out. And a couple of devs, you know, recognized me, came over. We had some conversations, kind of talked about the game, just CD Projekt Red as a whole. I was kind of talking about my love of The Witcher and, you know, why I have a lot of respect for what that studio does, and just fantastic conversations. Really was a lot of fun with that. Took a lot of pictures, video, you know, inside the meeting room because they had it all decked out and, you know, just kind of that cyberpunk vibe. I was really hoping Mike Pondsmith would have been there when I was there, but he was not, unfortunately, but that's okay. The head of CD Projekt Red was there as well, so it was great to meet him. Just fantastic. This is just leading into the demo. So Miles, and I don't even want to try and pronounce Miles' last name because I'll screw it up, but Miles, he is the lead level designer for Cyberpunk 2077, and he also worked on The Witcher 3. You know, I had a nice long conversation with him, and then he actually was the one that gave the presentation of the demo that I got to watch. So did all that. I knew Danny and Pete were going to do something when I left the demo. Actually, I had my good friend Dan with me too. He was sitting right next to me. So I went into the demo. I sat dead center right behind the person that was playing the demo. So I had like the perfect front row seat to watch that demo when I was in there. And like I was saying, I knew Danny and Pete were going to have something. Like, I knew they were probably going to film my reaction again or whatever. So I was prepared for it. So when the demo ends, you know, long line getting out, I'm kind of more of one of the last people to get out, and I can hear all this clapping and cheering as I'm making my way to the door. So what happened was Danny arranged with PR over at CD Projekt Red, all these acronyms, to have everybody that was at the show for CD Projekt Red greet me when I came out the door. So, you know, as people are coming out, they're cheering for him. So I can see this as I'm starting to walk out. So me, I have 1,000 thoughts running through my head. I'm like, what do I do? What do I say? And I just went with it, man. They were cheering and I just ran out that door and I just celebrated because I was just so happy for that moment because I felt like it just culminated a year of anticipation to see this demo and what it was going to be. And just like I said, all the connections that I've made over the past year with people at the studio and just other fans of the game and things like that. So to have everybody from CD Projekt Red, like just genuinely there excited, like, hey, we know this is the dude from last year in the video, and they're just cheering and we're all shaking hands, and it was fantastic. And you can see that video for yourself. Danny has it on his Twitter timeline. I have it on my Twitter timeline. I put it up on my IG as well. But yeah, it was just one of those moments that you'll never forget because it was so genuine and I was truly happy. I mean, I didn't know how I would react, but that was just my reaction. It was just happiness because I felt like this is a studio. And like I said, just getting to know some of these people just a little bit, but knowing them a little bit, like they're truly passionate about this game. They're not just trying to make a game to make a boatload of cash. Obviously, money factors into everything we do. But they're trying to make a game that they want to play, that they want to have fun with. And that's what Cyberpunk is truly shaping up to be. And like I said, you can just see the passion from everyone at that studio that was at E3, you know, and I truly appreciated that. I respected it. And like I said, it is a moment. It is the best moment I've ever had at an E3 ever. It is literally one of my all-time favorite moments, period, to have that happen. It's something I won't soon forget. And I'm very thankful for it. So the demo, I had a good friend of mine ask me at dinner that night. Excuse me. Oh, and let me backtrack before I actually get into that. So another highlight was I did go to the public booth, cause I wanted to check it out on the show floor, and I got to meet the community manager for CD Projekt Red, and she's been mad cool with me on Twitter. So it was very nice to meet her face to face. And, you know, we had a brief conversation, took a couple photos and all that, but extremely nice. And just, again, I'm just humbled by the entire experience. But okay, so like I said, went to dinner that night after E3 with some good friends. And one of them turned to me and goes, said, it was great. He saw the video, said it was a great moment, and he didn't want me to take it in a negative way what he was about to ask, but he said he watched the 25-minute version of the demo at the public booth. I haven't seen it, so I don't know. I've only seen the 50-minute video that they showed us privately, but he was like, he didn't get it. He didn't understand why did I think Cyberpunk was just this revolutionary thing. Why should he be so excited about it? And he wasn't saying it in a negative way. And I totally knew what he meant because this demo that I saw, the full 50 minutes, is drastically different than the first one that you can go watch on YouTube right now from 2018. What I felt they tried to do in 2018 was they were trying to show you, yo, here's this world that we've created. Here's just the nitty gritty of it. Here's some cool shit that you can do in this world. And it was kind of the glamour and the glitz version of it to get the novice that has no idea what Cyberpunk is all about to kind of get you hooked in. That's what that first demo was about. And guess what? It freaking worked, because I'm gonna be perfectly honest with you. I knew of Cyberpunk going into it, but I wasn't a hardcore fan. But seeing that demo last year made me go do the work so that I could actually understand this world and understand what the hype about it was. So that's what I felt like the first demo did its job. It did it very well. It got me excited about the world of Cyberpunk. It made me think, and this is coming from CD Projekt Red, and it's an open world game from a developer that I trust, that in my opinion has made one of the best games of this generation, if not the best game of this generation, in The Witcher 3. Sign me up. I'm all in. And that's what created that love affair for the past year, which culminated into this. But let's just flash forward to now with this demo that we have here in 2019. It's not the action-packed glitz thing that's just going to get your heart pumping. It's more of a thing of, here's the world. You already know what the world is. Here's how this world works. Here's how the factions work. Here's how the technology in here works. Here's how Here's how you can customize the skills to have your V work for you in the way that you want it to work. That's what I took out of this. Like, the thing, and again, I'm not going to try and go too in-depth with like spoilers and what I saw, because I want people to really experience this for themselves. But, you know, we got two different versions of V. We got the male version that you see in the trailer, and then we got the female version that obviously would have been in the previous demo. And the male version is the Netrunner. That's the hacker. That's the one that's going to use his hacking skills to be able to get his objective done. And then we saw a second version of V, which was the female version, which was more of kind of your melee brute force tank version that you can have. We got to see some shots of the actual skill tree that's in there, and it's vast, and there's just so many different things that you can put your skill points into to customize your V to your play style. I mean, it's very Deus Ex in that way, which again, if you go back to the late 90s, that was the original vision of Deus Ex, you know what I mean? So that's what we kind of got to see early on, you know, just those differences. But then they kind of went into, we saw some of the factions, like the one that we start off with is the Voodoo Boys, and those are the Haitians. They're speaking Creole, and I love that they're literally speaking Creole, and there's the translator there to let you know what they're saying. And then really good friend of mine, Uriah, Andrew from the show Radio, he has a video that's gone a little viral as well after seeing it, and he knows Creole. He's Haitian, he knows. And he was so excited because it was truly speaking, like he could understand what it was saying, and the translation was right there with it as well. So that was awesome. The other faction that we saw in there were the animals. And this faction, and I know there's been a little controversy in it because, you know, oh, they're black people and all that stuff, and people are trying to draw race and all that nonsense into it. That honestly isn't the problem, because they're called the animals. They're called the animals because there's this vicious faction, which, again, if you go on the Pondsmith, he's the one that named them, and he purposely gave them that name. There's just these strong, vicious people that they are like animals. That's why that faction is called the animals. But, you know, they're kind of they're on the juice. They're all roided out. You know what I mean? They're just these big hulking NPCs that you'll see. And I love how they took a scenario where you went in as a Netrunner and use your hacking skills to solve the objective. And then they showed, all right, here's how it would work using the female V as kind of the tank melee. And it was completely different scenarios, but getting to the same objective as the end. And that's just two of many different scenarios you'll be able to tackle that way, depending on how you spec out your character. And that's what got me excited. I'll give one little tiny spoiler in there. There's a section with the animals where you approach these animals, and they're one of them's boxing with, my kids are back, so they're being loud. And they're boxing. Hold on one sec. I'm recording. You're being loud. Father's Day. So you're boxing. He's boxing with one of the robot things. You actually see this in the previous demo. And you hack the robot boxer, and you basically set him to kill, and he literally knocks the dude's heads off. It's awesome. Again, I don't want to get too in-depth with that stuff, but that was just one example, you know, with the Netrunner that you'll be able to tackle a situation. And then the other being the melee tank, there was a section where you couldn't get through this door as the Netrunner, but as the melee tank, you could literally use your brute strength to open the door, and you could just skip a whole section and get right to the end of the objective. Just little things like that I really liked. Again, they kind of showed off the fast travel that's in the game. But again, there's no load times at all in the entire open world. And the only reason we saw the fast travel is just because they wanted to switch between characters and show us that it was there. But the thing, like I was saying, that excited me so much about what I think Cyberpunk is going to be is the world that Mike Pondsmith has created, you know, through Cyberpunk 2020 and just the books and everything, the tabletop RPG. And then you have a developer like CD Projekt Red, who has earned our trust, that is translating this into an open world. And we're starting to see those things that were coming from the previous Cyberpunk being translated in 2077 into a video game, into an open world RPG. And just the possibilities are endless. Like, you can even take that E3 trailer. That is just one scenario where, like, you know, Jackie dies in the car. That doesn't necessarily happen in every scenario when you tackle it. It all depends on how you do, because if you listen carefully to that trailer, they went in guns blazing to get that chip, right? you don't have to do that if you don't want to. So what happens in a scenario where you don't go in gun blazing and you just simply steal it or you make a deal to get it? Jackie doesn't die, right? So that's going to branch off into a whole nother path. And again, if you played The Witcher 3, you understand what I mean by this and why it gets me so excited, because there were so many scenarios in The Witcher 3. Depending on the choice that you made, NPCs could die early on and you never see them again, or there could be some that will be with you all the way to the end of the story. Really, the choice is up to you and how you want to tackle it. And again, just going from some of the conversations that I had with some people at CD Projekt Red, they've taken those lessons learned from The Witcher 3 and they're applying them into Cyberpunk 2077. And when I think, it's like, okay, they've got all this knowledge from this other open world game, which was a smash success, that they can now apply and improve on in this one, just gets me excited. It really does. And like I said, I can't wait. Graphically, it obviously looks fantastic. We know we're getting an Xbox One and PS4 version, PC version. PC version, it was announced they did partner with NVIDIA, and we're going to get RTX as well. We'll TBD on what my rig's going to look like, but I'm definitely going to build a new one in early 2020. Hopefully, either NVIDIA or AMD has a GPU that really excites me going into next year. Like, I'm just honestly not a fan of the 2080 line, so I hope something else comes early 2020 that excites me and is more price conscious as well, so that when I build my new rig, because that's where I'll be playing Cyberpunk, will be on PC. But like I said, overall, just very, very impressed by that demo. I truly want people to experience it for themselves. If you're going to go to Gamescom, you'll be able to see it there. They're going to show it at PAX. And then after PAX, they're going to release it to the public, similar to what they did with the demo from 2018. But like I said, don't let anyone ruin it for you. Experience it for yourself. Judge it for yourself. What they showed me, the nitty gritty of it, excited me, because this is truly going to be a living, breathing world, because they took us to a whole nother area. It's called Pacifica. It was kind of a more of industrial area. It wasn't the glamour and glitz, you know, just that near future look that we saw in the original demo. This was, like I said, more gritty. It was an area of Night City that people don't go to. It's a lot more dangerous, things like that. And like I said, just listening to the NPCs, like the voodoo boys in the background kind of talking, they're talking politics and religion and just all these things that are going on that you aren't affecting. They're going about their lives with or without you. You just happen to be a character in that world trying to make your way. And that's what excites me about it. You know, it's very ambitious, man. It really is. You know, going into 2020, I can't think of anything else that would top my list for most anticipated game. And when April 16th, 2020 gets here, I mean, I'm ready. Speaking of that date, CD Projekt Red had that date in the first demo. Now, if you go back and watch the first demo, they clearly hint at February 16th, 2020 being the launch date for this game, which again is fantastic. Kind of goes to show you, you know, they've had a plan for a long time and what they want to do. Which brings me to the final point of this. Keanu Reeves, Johnny Silverhand. He's obviously a NPC that's going to be in the game. He is in your head, so to speak, almost like you're conscious, but seeing the demo, not really. He kind of has his own agenda, and he will make comments along the way about what he thinks you should be doing versus what you're actually doing, which I think is fantastic. It's from everything I understand. He's not just making a quick little guest appearance. He will be a character that will be around throughout the duration of the game. And obviously there's secrets and everything that goes with that. But I think it was an amazing get by CDPR to get Keanu Reeves, because that was the other thing. Just kind of talking a couple of devs, you know, he's not just there just picking up a paycheck. I mean, he's invested into it as well. You obviously saw his excitement when he was out there on the Xbox stage as well. All that was genuine from what those guys were telling me. I mean, he's really into it. So that excites me too, to see that, you know, dude, Keanu Reeves is a freaking rock star right now. And to see his involvement in this game, you know, makes a lot of sense, you know, from a business standpoint. Again, he's very marketable. It is very clear moving forward, he will be the face of this game going into launch next year. It just makes sense. And if he's also into it as well, plays a big part into it, that's just icing on the cake. And which, again, I guess one thing I didn't really touch on too much was, you know, there's the whole creator character. And that's why I know people are kind of getting upset. Oh, they're doing this white male protagonist on the box art, blah, 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 blah. But remember this, you get to design your own V. the way that you want it to be. And trust me, my V will be black and beautiful and most likely female with a big giant Angela Davis afro, because that's what I plan on doing. That's going to be my V. That's how I plan to play Cyberpunk. But you get to play the way you want to. And that's the beauty of this game. And yes, there are other RPGs out there that do similar things, or other RPGs that do open world. But I look at it this way. And again, why it gets me excited. This is an open world RPG from a developer that knows what the hell they're doing. They have set the gold standard for this with The Witcher 3. And I fully expect nothing less from them with Cyberpunk 2077. Plus, Mike Pondsmith is fully involved with this. So we're going to get all the backstory and the lore of the Cyberpunk world in this as well. I just think the combination is going to be fantastic. I really do. I will shamelessly say that I would love to be able to go to Gamescom this year to see more of it potentially. But if that doesn't happen, once the full marketing picks up, probably end of this year going into 2020, I'm not going to lie, I want to go to that studio. I want to go to CDPR. I would absolutely love to be able to go to that studio, talk to more of these developers, talk about this game, maybe potentially get hands on early, do preview content, the whole thing. That's what I personally want to do. That is literally, boom, in my bucket list, I want to do. I'll see if I can make that happen. But if I don't, that's okay too, because trust me, I will be there April 16th, 2020, playing it day one regardless. But, you know, I definitely have a high respect for that studio, the people that work there, and just the work that they do. I think it's fantastic. So that's Cyberpunk 2077. I think I've talked enough about it. I could talk all day about it. Like I said, I don't want to give up too much of the demo. I want people to experience for themselves. But I hope people that are watching this or listening to it can at least appreciate and enjoy my impressions on it. And I'm sure if you got questions, everything, definitely hit us up, fanmail@gamertagradio.com, and we'll try and answer those questions in the future. And obviously hit me up on Twitter at vicious696. So, final thing. Today's Father's Day. And last night I got the ultimate Father's Day gift, because I am a Laker fan. I'm a die easy. I am not a die easy. I'm a die hard Laker fan. I don't know why I said die easy. But I'm a die hard Laker fan, through thick and thin, through the good and the bad and the ugly. And I'll tell you, 3 weeks ago, it was looking rough. Magic Johnson scorched the earth on the way out the door, just bad-mouthed the whole front office. We were the laughing stock of the league. It was like, we're going to get no free agents. LeBron, it was like, oh, my God, LeBron's going to try and force a trade. You know, everything's going to crash and burn. And what happened yesterday? They got Anthony Davis. They got one of the top five players in this league. He's going to get to play with LeBron while LeBron is still playing at a peak level. Yeah, we had to trade the kids, but we kept one of them. We kept Kyle Kuzma. Yeah, we gave up some first-round picks for the future, but the Lakers are trying to win now. That's what the Lakers do. And we still got cap room to either try and go get one more max guy like Kemba Walker, or take that max money, split it up. Let's build up the depth on the team. Let's get some 3-and-D guys. Let's get some perimeter defense guys. Let's get some three-point shooters. I mean, that's the template right now in the NBA to win. You got AD, you got LeBron, who are going to draw double and triple teams in the paint, kick it out to a dude, he's going to be wide open, got to hit your shots. And then when you go up against the Hardens and the Dames and the Stephs of the world, you know, that are out there creating on the perimeter, you got to have a guy that can D him up. You know, you got Kawhi. We don't know if he's staying in Toronto, he's coming to the West or whatever, but either way, the West is wide open now with Kevin Durant getting injured, going to be out for the whole year. Klay, my man Klay, I love Klay. Klay getting, you know, the ACL tear and most likely out either the majority of the year or all of next year. I mean, Golden State's not going to be that great of a team next year. Will they make the playoffs? Probably. I mean, Steph's that great of a player. But they're not going to be the dominant team that they were. Denver, I mean, I expect them to be a threat. They're still young, though. They're vulnerable. You know, we got Portland. Nokic comes back, I mean, they're obviously going to be a huge threat as well. Utah has come up as well. Clippers, Jerry West, Doc, I mean, they're building that team. Let's see who they get in free agency. The West is wide open. And now that we got AD, we're instantly going to be able to contend in that. The East, I don't know if Kawhi's staying. I don't know if he's leaving. Giannis got to develop a 15-foot jumper. But all that's wide open, too. The NBA is so exciting right now. I can't wait till the draft on Thursday. And then, obviously, free agency coming up here in a couple weeks. It's going to be a lot of fun. It'll be interesting to see where everyone goes. Unfortunately, I think the big loser out of all of this is going to be the New York Knicks. A couple weeks ago, it looked like KD, Kyrie, no brainer. They're going. Maybe they can swing a trade, get AD and have their own super team. And now they're going to be back. Now AD obviously isn't going. Strong hints that Kyrie's going to go to Brooklyn. And KD might after everything is gone, KD might just stay in Golden State. He may not go anywhere. You know, he may sign the max deal, heal up a year, and then, you know, Klay does the same, and then they just throw away this season, come back in 2021 and make a run again, fully loaded once again. So we'll see, man. But that'd be unfortunate if the Knicks completely strike out on everything, especially since they traded Porzingis in anticipation of all this happening. But been a great weekend for me. Been a great week. E3 was really great. And that's the one thing about E3 that can never be replaced. And despite me going, oh, it's dying and oh, they got to do this and that. But just seeing the people, man. It's just seeing the people, seeing old friends, making new ones. You know, I talk a lot about my social anxiety on Twitter a lot. And this was actually a really good week of me overcoming a lot of that. I made it a point, especially Sunday during the Xbox briefing, to actually approach people myself and say, hello, how you doing, that kind of thing. And then even during the week, I had a lot of people approaching me. And it was very humbling as that was happening, especially like at the mixer Monday night at Ubisoft. I had a lot of people coming up to me that knew me. And I was like, wow, really? People don't take pictures of me. It was like blowing me away. But I definitely made a point to, you know, purposely reach out to people, say hello, talk to them, have conversations, just things like that. And I was so happy that I was able to accomplish, you know, get over the hump on that barrier, so to speak. And, you know, it's always going to be a struggle with me. That's why I kind of openly talk about it, because I know other people struggle from it too. But sometimes, like, I'll tell you a perfect example. I'm at the Bungie thing, right? And, you know, I know Deej, I know, like, Noseworthy, Luke Smith, some people, but there are a lot of people there I didn't know. And there was that moment where I kind of panicked a little bit and I almost had my flight reaction where let's just get out of here. You've shown your face, just leave. You're good. And I was like, you know what? No, I'm not leaving. I want to be here. Took a deep breath. I was like, you're good. Wound up having fantastic conversations the whole time I was there. And I'm glad I didn't leave. Really glad I didn't leave. I fought that urge. You know what I mean? So, like I said, if I can do it, anyone can do it. You know, it is. I just think it's a human reaction to have these issues, but it's okay. We're all just people, and that's the one thing we got to remember. We're all just people. We're all going to be shy about certain things, but you won't get to know the person that you want to know if you're afraid to approach them. You just got to look at it that way. So I think that's my final words of advice on that. Like I said, E3 was a great time. I'll obviously hanging out with Danny and Pete. Love them. They're my brothers, and nothing can ever change that or replace that. Again, I'm just thankful for all the opportunities that we've been able to get over the years. And this week was definitely a reminder of that. And I'm just thankful. I'm just blessed. Like I said, I love video games. I'm 45 years old. I still play video games. That's okay. I obviously hop on stream, put myself out on camera, talking about it, do a podcast, all that stuff. But it's okay because I'm doing what I love to do. You know, I have my family. I love them to death and they support me 100% and everything's great. So I feel like I have talked a lot and my family is back from the store. So I should probably go check them out and see what they're doing. This right now, the stream, I will turn it into a podcast. It will be on a podcast. I will also be putting this out on YouTube as well. So everyone that kind of hung out in the stream with me right now, I truly appreciate it. For those that are listening on the Gamertag Radio feed, thank you. Appreciate support. And if you're on YouTube, thank you for the support there as well. Definitely going to keep doing more of these, trying to practice, trying to get better at it. But you know, it's just one of those things. I just love doing this stuff. But that was my week at E3. That was my thoughts on Cyberpunk, and I'm excited as hell about Anthony Davis. So thank you everyone for hanging out with me. I really appreciate it, and I will be talking to you again real soon. Peace out.